Hey everyone, and welcome to another episode. I'm Ombarus, and this week is part 2 of my localization series. And if you haven't seen part 1, I highly suggest you go and check it out, because it covers all the basic on how to set up translation on Godot, how to translate string, how to format them, and so on. And this episode is going to be more about like the general idea of localization and all the challenges you can encounter when trying to port from one language to another, at least my personal experience of it. The point I want to address in this episode today is why I think localization is important. And I think localization is very important. Of course, big companies, big AAA game, big movies, they will always translate their game for all the markets around the world. And yes, they might not do it right away. You know, a movie that comes out in America might come out a couple of months later in Japan, or even a few weeks later in France or England, or, you know, they will take the time to localize for every market after the main event, but they will still do it. And what about little indie developer like myself? Do we have any reason to try to market to people outside of the target language we are developing in? And honestly, I'm still not sure, because my game is so small, is it worth the time and effort to translate all of the strings in it and do all the work that needs to be done to make it work? But at the same time, for me personally, it gives me content for my YouTube channel, so it's not totally wasted time, right? If you're watching my channel, you're probably perfectly fluent in English, and what you might not realize is that it's not the case for everyone. There are studies that show that only 20% of the world population speak English. That leaves a whooping 80% of people that will not be able to enjoy your content. And if you're a small-time creator, if you're a niche market, you know, if your game targets some very specific type of people, then you're skimping on already a small pool of people. You know, maybe there's only 100 people who want to buy your game. And if you make it only in English, then it means you're only targeting 20 of those 100 people. So that's kind of, you know, shooting yourself in the feet, even as a small indie developer. And on top of that, even if you look at just the size of the market, it used to be only about America. America was spending like 10 times as much money on video games as any other countries in the world. But that's not so true anymore. The biggest market now is China. And behind America, which is second, there's still a lot of other countries climbing up the stairs, like Japan, France, Germany, and they're all in the top 5. Not only that, but because of the difference in cultures in every country, some games will just perform better in different countries. And it's kind of hard sometimes to know. Of course, there's stuff like JRPG, they're very popular in America, but they're nothing compared to in Japan. I mean, Japan only plays JRPG, basically. I mean, it's in the name. So I hope this kind of convinced you why I think localization is important. And let's go back into like how I went about localizing my own game. My game has a lot of text, and I mean a lot. When I started doing the translation, I didn't really realize how much work it was going to be. Just copying the string from the code and then putting it in the CSV file and then adding all the translation, it takes a huge amount of time. But doing these kind of repetitive work eventually makes you realize a couple of things. And I started implementing some methods that are not necessarily necessary for making the translation, but that kind of helped me figure things out. The first thing I implemented was a wrapper around the tr function. It's already such a simple method, you wonder why would you need to wrap it? It's just perfect the way it is. And it's kind of true, but I needed a couple of different things, and it was just easier to do it if I wrapped the tr method in my own method. So yes, you can do tr and then, you know, get the translated string and then call the format method on it or something like that. But I found that it was just simpler for me to have my own method that can take a parameter and I can just pass it the formatting parameter along with the translation, and I'll handle all of that by itself. And the way I did that, of course, is just making it global. I have already an autoload that's called globals, so I just created my tr and I can call it from anywhere in the code, basically, and it'll return me the translated string. And the main reason I was doing that, actually, is also to create some validation. One thing I really like when I'm doing translation is having a way to generate reports about the missing translation line. And the ideal way to do it is that while I'm playing the game, this report is being generated in the background and I can check it out later. And the cherry on top of everything is if I can get a report for all the language at the same time, meaning I can play the game in English while debugging something and then check the report and see all the missing string in French and Japanese and Spanish and whatever. Sadly, in Godot, I couldn't find a way to do that. There's something called the translation server in Godot that you can access to get information, set the local and stuff like that. But you don't seem to have access to the actual translation table, so you can't just get raw data from the translation. So you can't like parse all the translation line and validate them at the beginning of the game or something like that. Or you can't check if a translation exists. It's just going to return you either the ID because it couldn't find the translation, or the translated sentence. So I still managed to find a way around that. In my custom TR method, what I do is that when I need some translation, I check if the return string is the same as the string I passed in. And if it's the same, I kind of assume that the translation didn't work. But it can create false positive because, for example, some words in English are the same in French. So then it'll think that the string wasn't translated. So I'd really like it if there was a way to validate, like for sure, if the string is in the translation table, but I just haven't managed to find a way to do that. I did find some Reddit post about someone saying that you can kind of access the table of the translation through the translation server, but someone said it would only work if you don't use compressed translation file, and it was from a post quite old. And it seemed to be for an older version of Godot, so like I kind of gave up and used my own like hack to get the report I wanted. But the funny part about this is that when I started doing validation, I started getting false positive. Beside the thing that I said, like some words are the same in different language, I started getting stuff I was trying to translate twice, so I would pass the English, get the French, and then later in my code, I would try to use this French for the translation again, which is fine because it's just going to return the same string that is already translated, so it's not going to crash or anything, but it'll generate error report for me. So to avoid this, I started having to implement new features that aren't really necessary because they're just for the validation, but to make sure I didn't get too many false positive and lose, you know, the actual important information, I started adding some parameters to some of my function to say like if this string needs to be translated or not. And this is really only for me to avoid getting spam with message that aren't important. For most of my translation and really any kind of text editing, I usually use Notepad++. I think it works really well as a simple text editing tool, and it has a lot of features that I've discovered over the years that I can use for all sorts of things. But to edit the CSV, sometimes when I had really long strings or a lot of lines to edit at the same time, since it didn't line up the columns for each language, it kind of was getting a little bit difficult to edit sometimes. So I just booted up LibreOffice, which is a free alternative to like Word document editing software. And it can load CSV file very easily, and you can edit them and then save them back as CSV file, and it just works really well. The only problem I had with that is that when the file is open in LibreOffice, it kind of locks the file. And if you go back into Godot, Godot will try to re-import the CSV file, but since the file is locked, it won't be able to read it, and then you'll get like a generic error message. And quite a few times I thought it was because there was something wrong in my CSV file, like I thought I put the comma somewhere and didn't put it into quotes, or that I was missing one of the columns or something like that, and to finally realize that I had LibreOffice open in the background and that's why it was failing to compile. Grammar is really a freaking bitch. You know, there's a reason why a lot of video games have just icons or really simple text in their UI. It's because translating whole sentences, especially if these sentences have to be dynamic, is a real big pain. And then trying to do it in different language, that's really hurtful. And the worst is, if you're developing in English, you might think that you got it down, that you can build sentence from basic building blocks and that it's going pretty well. But from my relative experience with three different languages, English is actually an easier language to do this with. French is a whole other matter, and Japanese is not that easy either. Of course, even in English, you have some issues with like plurals where you have to add an S if there's more than one. You might have stuff like I was doing in my game, like I wanted to write first or second or third or and so on based on the number. And if I want to abbreviate it, then I have to change dynamically the abbreviation and so on. It can be kind of complicated, but it's nothing compared to French with all the determinant we have in French. Let me give you an example of some of the determinant we have in French. In French, you have words like water, which would be de l'eau. And you have words like life, which would be de la vie. And then you have words like milk, which would be du lait. And to make things even worse, you would have stuff like le chat, that can also be pronounced un chat. And that's cat in English. But not the same cat, because we use un or le. So how do you deal with that in your translation? Because English doesn't have that, so when I try to port my stuff to English, sometimes I'm faced with the wrong gender or the wrong determinant in French, and I don't know how to swap them. Really, it's just something I haven't fixed yet. It looks kind of broken when you're reading some of the sentence. You'll understand the meaning, but I don't have a good way to make it sound perfect in French, and I'm not quite sure how I'm gonna do that. You need some kind of grammar engine. But then you need a different one for every language you want to implement, and that's kind of hard. That's one of the reasons that I don't think games like Dwarf Fortress will ever be able to be really translated in a different language. The game literally has a grammar engine in it to generate all the stories and the legend and stuff like that. And if you haven't played that game, I really suggest you go check it out. It's really amazing what they can do. And I've seen some members on the forum trying to do some translation in Russian, but they even themselves recognize that there's some serious issues that they can't fix with the grammar. So, you know, for now, I kind of gave up on just having the perfect grammar for my strings, because, like, I don't want to spend another 2 weeks trying to explore a way to, you know, maybe have different gender in my IDs so that I can use the right ID for the right gender or something like that. Yes, it looks a little bit like mistakes when you're reading it, but at least you understand it, and yeah, you know, for now it'll do. If you're planning to do translation for your game, you should really think about the space in your design of the UI, because some sentence in some language will be much longer and some sentences will be much shorter, leaving your user to wonder why is there so much space in this UI design, or why doesn't the text line up in the buttons. And there's actually a section in Godot's documentation about using other apps for label and containers that resize automatically to help you mitigate this potential issue when doing translation. But the truth is that any good design usually would have a somewhat flowy layout, because you want to support multiple resolution, multiple aspect ratio, and so on. So that's not really a solution to the problem, because often you'll still end up with issues because your button can only fit in this tiny space, and you know, there's stuff around it and it just has nowhere to flow. In these cases, you still have to have thought about the design beforehand so that you have planned for it. For example, my game has a lot of lists, and I made sure that the row of each of my lists was just big enough that if I needed to, I could put two lines of text. The design is not made for that. It looks much better, I think, with only one line. But it's arguably better to wrap to a second line if I need to, than to crop the text because it overflows. And yeah, this is pretty much what I wanted to talk about for translation. I've been doing this for the past 1 month or so, and it's really getting on my nerve, all the issues and all the problem and all the time it's taking and all just the work of just putting all the strings in the text. And it's been a really long process, and I'm glad I could just a little bit get it out of my system through these videos. And I hope it's going to be useful for some people. Please leave a comment, a like, if you find this useful or enjoyable, and if you have any comments or suggestions about how I could improve things, and I hope to see you guys in my next episode. Bye!